there is no religion higher than truth. Ekam sat viprabhudha vadanti. Truth is one. Sages know it by various names. This is a journey into the depths of time, to the unfading power of the progenitors of the divine race who shaped these creations. Stone sculptures stand as the guards at the edge of eternity. The incoming will be asked, "What do you carry so that you may pass?" And no gift other than love will be accepted. The wandering sadhus, strolling through the spaces in their spiritual walks, will slip past. Gigantic faces with a smile of Gioconda preserve the secrets of millennia. Mythological stories of the Indian epic, the Mahabharata, about the creation of the world. The hero of one of the books of Mahabharata was shown all forms of creation, and he exclaimed, "I behold thee with myriads of arms, faces, and eyes. I behold thee infinite in form on every side, but I see not thy end, nor thy middle, nor thy beginning, O Lord of the universe, O universal form." The setting sun illuminated the basalt hills of the western slopes. Elena stepped on the ancient land of India. In front of her, a boundless depth lost in the waves of moonlight. Behind her, dark vaults of caves dug by an unheard race at unknown times and unknown in honor of what prehistoric faith. One of the legends narrates that the temple of Shiva, glorified by Mahabharata, was erected on the Elephanta island by the sons of Pandu, but the folk song is also not affirmative on the point. Centuries have passed and will pass, but the age-old mystery will perish in the rocky chest of the cave. "I was like in a dream," wrote Helena Petrovna in her letter to Prince Dondukov. "While traveling around India, every month I used to receive money, having no idea from whom. I voluntarily followed the route given to me." Nowhere in India can you find more evidence of the power of the Mughal Empire than in Agra, the ancient capital of Akbar. What a precious pearl, the Taj Mahal, an inexpressible beauty. It stands alone on the bank of the blue Jamuna River. It is hard to believe that it is the work of mortals, but it is easy to believe a local legend. After the death of his beloved wife, Shah Jahan, in his dream, was ascended to the heavenly abode, where Allah himself commanded Archangel Gabriel to copy for him the plan of one of his abodes. According to this plan, the Taj Mahal was built over the body of his beloved wife Mumtaza. This mausoleum is a dream from Thousand and One Nights. This morning we leave the Mohammedan glory and enter the land of Rajasthan. The history of Rajasthan is traced back 3,000 years before Christ. The land of fairy tale and historical heroes of frenzied daringness and chivalrous feelings towards the women. The land of those who created the sacred order of the host, honored to die in a battle, but not in a bed from an old age. Wives of the fallen warriors were voluntarily ascending the funeral pyre of the widows, leaving their handprints on the wall of fame. Sikhs and Rajputs are one of the most beautiful types of the human race. All surroundings, the entire country, is dotted with the symbols of gods and goddesses. Each one of the 33 million deities of the Indian pantheon has somewhere its representative. With every step, there is someone's shrine. The temples of Khajuraho are an echo of the memories of a failed race that disappeared in prehistoric times from the map of creations. Mysterious and grandiose past of India, the ancient Aryavarta, its present is a black shadow on a light background. India is indebted to Buddhism. India became decrepit and has fallen just as the great monuments of antiquity are falling, crushing to smithereens. But then each of the smallest fragments will remain a jewel forever. Great Buddha, through the fire of his heart, was able to extract the truth from the vaults of the Vedas and bring it to the world. He spoke about himself. Buddha is only the name of infinite knowledge, infinite as the heavens. Strive for knowledge. Your work is your only salvation, and the key to all the thrones and powers of the universe. Mother Ganga. Its origins are the glaciers of the roof of the world, the power, fullness and force, flying not from the earth, but flying to the earth, from another world, the infinite horizons of light and love, which we call the God and heavens. Ganga, the healing hymn of life. Enter that river, lie down on the bottom, and let the water flow around your tired body. Drink from the river of life, and then rise and go into the world. You are no longer a weary traveler. You are already part of her power. Go into the world and work. Do not beg the God for alms. Do not rely on rituals. The God helps those who help themselves. Stand up and fight. Fight and bring the trifles of your life to the highest, like that river which carries its sacrificial waters to the purity of the altars of freedom, soaring in the sky. And the toll of children's eyes shines with a flame of joy and hope. I lived in India for about 2 years, recalls Blavatsky. I received letters from the master, but I never saw him. Why has this person acquired such an influence over me? I don't know. But if he told me to jump into an abyss, I wouldn't hesitate for a second. I was afraid of him. I don't know why, for I never met a man softer and simpler than him. In the last letter, the master wrote, "Go back to Europe and do whatever you want, but be ready to return at any time. Remember not to forget. Forget that you need to remember." It was an early morning. Fog was approaching the southern edge of the valley. Helena was returning from her magical journey through the ancient lands of India. From memoirs of her sister, Vera Zelichowski. In London, Helena became famous for her musical talent and was a member of the Philharmonic Society. She resumed playing music and signed a contract for a number of piano concerts. Blavatsky's associate in the Theosophical Society, Henry Olcott, wrote in his diary, "She was a great pianist. Her hands a perfect model for a sculptor. They flew over the piano like the birds, extracting magical sounds. The fading light of the evening flowed through the drawn curtains and moved the shadows in the room. Helena understood that the one who chose the path of knowledge must be ready for loneliness and life that becomes a battlefield. From Memoirs of Our Sister, Vera Zhelikhovsky. In London happened a loud process that made a lot of noise in the press. The Russian-Turkish war began with the participation of England. One day, in the theater foyer, one obese lord began to curse Russia and its army. Pale with indignation, Blavatsky stated that she is Russian and requests him to get silent. The lord responded with insolence. "If your friends cannot silence you, then I will." "How will you do that?" "I do not know how, but I repeat, shut up or..." She did not have time to finish the sentence as heavy chandelier fell on the lord's head. There was a trial. The judges, taking into account the circumstances, acquitted Blavatsky, and, in mockery of the lord, she was fined £5. "I'm giving 10 for the future," declared Blavatsky under common laughter. The white cover stretched for hundreds of kilometers. Russia. Traveling around the world, Helena felt that the current carries her to the east. The wind rustled in the branches of trees, recalling the whisper of long-forgotten voices. In her diary, we read the entry. "My heart ached for all my country, for Russia so dear to me. I would give my soul for her in bondage for 10,000 years. What a happiness to be Russian." It was Christmas Eve, 1859. It was a sign for Helena. Christmas festivities. Festivities in memory of heavenly mystery. From Memoirs of Our Sister, Zhelikhovsky. The guests sat at the table. The doorbell rang continuously. We were not awaiting sister's arrival, but on the next call I jumped, knowing for sure that she has arrived. We hugged each other. Helena was absent for almost 10 years. From her travels, she returned a person gifted with exceptional powers and abilities. The family was about to move to the estate of the Pskov province, the village Rugodevo.
Моей святыне красоте Пою я песнь любви и воли моей святыни красоте. Пою я песнь любви и воли, я только странник на земле, и горек хлеб пути земного, но жизнь вечная.
From Zhelikhovsky's memoirs. Helena turned out to be the strongest medium. Excited noble society craved for the miracles and phenomena. But her father, Peter Alexeyevich Han, and Helena's brother Leonid remained unbelievers. Leonid was a sturdy, stocky youth imbued with the wisdom of the University of Derb. He stood behind her and listened to the stories about the magnetism of German Professor Hume, about how the light objects could be made heavy. And can you do that? Sometimes I did. Can you try? Fine, I will. Helena fixed her big blue eyes on the chess table and, without taking her eyes off it, invited one young man to leave the table. The young man confidently took hold of the table, but it did not move. "Well, that's a good one," he said. "Truly a thing," exclaimed Leonid, suspecting a conspiracy. "Can I try?" "Sure." The brother grabbed the table by its leg and pulled upward. The smile faded from his face. The wood cracked, but the table did not move. "Strange." His eyes looked at his sister. Helena laughed and said, "Try now." The brother pulled the table and it flew up, almost twisting his hands. Only Helena's father remained unperturbed. At the invitation to participate in the experience, he replied that all this is nonsense and grandmother's tales, and continued to play solitaire. However, later he agreed. He wrote a question on a piece of paper and put it in his pocket without showing it to anyone. With the help of Knox and alphabet, one word was formed. "Well, ready to answer?" "But there's only one word there." "Which one?" "Bunny." Peter Alexeyevich turned pale. He silently took out a note, and this is what was written in it. "What was the name of my war horse on which I made the Crimean Turkish Company?" And in the brackets, "Bunny." This bunny had a great impact. The change was dramatic and instantaneous, as it often happens with the skeptics, believing one fact, they accept everything. Zhelikhovsky continues her narration. "We got into the magical world of fairy tales with unexplained movements of the furniture, knocks, and intervention of some rational force into our daily life. And we just regained our senses when we heard the piano playing purely and well-performed Beethoven sonata. But the room was empty, and the chords vibrated under the closed piano lid. Estate for more than a year and in the summer of 1860, the sisters left for Caucasus to visit their grandmother and aunt. For 3 weeks of travel, strange phenomena occurred quite often. But the most unusual thing happened in Zadonsk, Voronezh region, in the lands of the Donskoy's army, in a famous center of pilgrimage where rested the relics of Saint Tichon of Zadonsk. On this day, the Metropolitan of Kiev, Reverend Isidore, prayed at the holy relics. We both knew him well during our life in Tiflis. The venerable old man recognized us and invited us to visit him. He received us affectionately. But as soon as we sat down, there started such a horrible hum and knock from all sides that even we thought was unusual. Everything in the hall knocked and rattled, the chandelier swayed, and the armchair moved. The insightful old man noticed our embarrassment and asked which one of the sisters has such a strange power. I pointed to Helena. He blessed her and said, "There is no power not of God. There are so many forces in nature, all of them far from being known, and it is not forbidden to explore them. Let the Mother of God bless you for everything good and kind." These words remained forever dear and memorable for Helena as an exceptional gift of an enlightened hierarch of the Russian Orthodox Church. In Tiflis, sisters moved into the house of their grandfather, Andrei Mikhailovich Fadeyev. In the fall of 1860, they lost their beloved grandmother, Helena Pavlovna. But the house still lived an active life, gathering the higher Tiflis society, Princess Rieli, Dadiani, Abashidze, and others. But like 12 years ago, Helena left Tiflis again. As she said, her soul felt tight and begged for space. Alone, Helena traveled through the wild lands of Transcaucasia with their huge rocks, prehistoric cave cities, and Kadianis, the native sorcerers lost in the woods. Her occult powers not only did not weaken, but grew stronger day by day. She became the talk of the region. The nobles of Guria and Mengrelia considered her enchantress, and the news of a Russian noblewoman wandering alone in the mountains spread widely among the population. Helena was in the ancient, semi-legendary land of Colchis, where once the hero of the ancient Greek epic, Jason, with his Argonauts, was looking for the golden fleece and kidnapped it with the help of the local king's daughter, Medea, the spellcaster and the sorceress. Some Colchis tribes were descendants of the Argonauts, proud hillmen and peasants. Helena traveled on horseback to their lands that resembled the fortresses. Possessing extraordinary abilities, she used to treat those in need. But the journey ended for her unexpectedly. In Mengrelia, Helena was overtaken by a mysterious disease. She grew so thin that she became a living skeleton. Local healers insisted she returns to Tiflis, and soon they sent her on a boat on the river Rioni. Sliding in despair between the high banks, Helena lay dying, and the boatmen swore they saw her slipping out of the boat, crossing the river by water, and disappearing into the woods. She slowly opened her eyes. They were almost empty. Then came to life and gazed intently into the distance. All this long, long day, in the morning, at noon, and at night, I appeal to the highest. Today, the God is the same as yesterday. And his voice reaches to the outskirts. Look, I, who was almost dead, am alive. There is no death here, nothing but life, life alone, life everywhere and forever. Zhelikhovsky recollects, Helena fought a great battle with occult powers that nearly killed her, and she came out of this struggle victorious. Helena herself wrote, the actions possess the power, especially if one who acts knows that it is the last battle on this earth. Helena, can you describe these powers? No, not really. I can name them differently, either as force, spirit, wind, or as love, will, action. The voice of the master. Get up. It is a new day, another new day. The days you left behind are the days of God. The days waiting for you ahead are his secret, and only this one hour is yours. Do not lose it. Live by flying now. This flying now directed Helena through the Central Asia, Balkans, and Greece to Italy, where she joined the ranks of the volunteer army of Garibaldi, who fought for the independence of Italy. A small city of Mentana, not far from Rome, became the site of an important battle between the forces of Garibaldi and the French troops supporting the Papal State. The Garibaldians lost this battle, but the spirit of freedom remained invincible. Helena took part in this battle as a soldier of the Garibaldi troops. Her left hand was slaughtered twice with a saber, and she received 2 bullet wounds in her right shoulder and the leg. When the wounded and killed were carried away, she was at first mistaken for dead. Later, there were a lot of rumors and speculations about her participation in the battle, but this is what Helena Petrovna wrote herself in a letter to Sinéad. Only the members of Garibaldi family know the whole truth. What I did there, you know partially, but you also do not know everything. Whether I was sent there by the master or just happened to be there is my own business. Recovering from her wounds, Helena traveled through the Balkans, waiting for the orders from her master. In 1868, she received a letter from her patron. My friend, my helper. Remember forever the brothers of the earth. Bow down to their suffering and joy, their rebellion and weakness, their peace and courage. Remember forever the greatness and horror of the human race. At the end of the letter, she was ordered to return through Constantinople to India and from there to proceed to Tibet. Charming expanses of Tibet, the country of eternal snows. A ghostly blue veil enveloped deserted giant mountains. Finally, the forbidden Tibet opened its arms to Helena. Tibet appeared before Helena in all its splendor of spiritual practices, with their grand and fantastic realism. They wanted to understand the universe, life, death, and the range of the possible for a man. Helena looked up from the ancient manuscripts. Some were in Vedic Sanskrit, others in sacred ancient language of Sanzar. Joy and happiness shone on Helena's face. Her eyes were like two hypnotic lakes of unfathomable depth. The sounds of a melodic spell were heard outside the window. They were pure as dawn, permeated with peaceful solitude. Helena was in the house of Kashmiri initiate Kuthumi Lal Singh, who lived with his sister. Her master Moria was also present here. "We have included you in our chain, and you will have to carry our thoughts wherever we indicate. Do not seek happiness, seek knowledge." Helena's heart was beating with tender devotion to her master. It was the most mysterious period in Helena's life, which she never shared with anyone. She stayed in closed communities of the Himalayan Brotherhood. "Time had disappeared from my life," she wrote later. "I wasn't aware what day, month, or year it is when I heard the voice of Master Hilarion. Get ready for one of the greatest encounters in your life. The one you will see descended from another planet to Earth in times immemorial." The silence, the dead silence of space, was interrupted by the Lord of the Great Power in a quiet but so clear voice that is impossible on Earth. He spoke. "I bless all those who help exhausted humanity on their way towards the light, forward in the battle for truth. Now it is time for you to go back to work among the people. It's been exactly 2 years since you walked in here, according to your Earth account." Hearing these words, I turned into a salt pillar. Master Hilarion brought me out of my stupor. He touched my forehead, chest, and shoulders crosswise with his wand and said, "My dear sister, carry your labor feet for the happiness and good of the people until the end of your earthly life in this body. The truth that lives in you does not need to be loosened. It gushes forth the purest fountain. No one will now prevent you from completing the mission entrusted to you by the Master Moria. Soon you depart to America to begin your new work there. But you will return here to receive the power to once again convey to people the voice of the sound of silence." Then the Master Kuthumi approached. He spoke with a gentle humor. "So, you mastered little of the secret knowledge. However, you learned English. Now you speak only slightly worse than I do." And he smiled. All this time, Helena's relatives were in complete obscurity. "We were ready to believe that she is not alive anymore," recalls her aunt, Надежда Андреевна Фадеева, "when a messenger of an Asian look appeared on the threshold. Handing over the letter, he disappeared right in front of my eyes. To the Honorable Madam Надежда Андреевна, Odessa. Your niece has not left this world. She is alive and wants to tell her dear ones that she is doing well and she is happy in her distant refuge. Rest assured, in 18 moons she will return to the family." As it turned out later, it was a letter from the Master Kuthumi. After 18 moons waxed and waned, Helena appeared in Odessa. This last visit to her homeland was short-lived, and in the spring of 1873 she set off for Paris. In Paris, Helena stayed with her cousin, Nicolas Gann, at the University Street 2. Those were long and wearisome years of my discipleship before I reached my goal. Starting from the first meeting with the Master Moria in London in 1851, I have never had any doubts about him. But trust alone is not enough. There are no such steps in discipleship where one can enter through another's experience. Only after desires are slain, an angel of peace raised from its ashes, can a man look into the face of God and stay alive. And stay alive. In Paris, Helena felt an irresistible desire to visit the Orthodox Church. This is what she wrote to her near ones. "I stood with my mouth open, as if in front of my dear mother, who I haven't seen in years and who can't recognize me. I don't believe in any dogma, but my feelings for the Orthodox service are completely different. I breathed in the air of mystery. My body felt warmth. This story is too intimate, too superior to anything that can be expressed in words." In Paris, Helena intended to stay for a while, but she received a letter from the master. He ordered her to depart for New York and wait for his further instructions there. A day later, Helena reached the port city of Le Havre with a first-class ticket bought with her last money. At a pier, she saw a crying woman with children. She was deceived by a fraud who sold her fake tickets. "Come with me," said Helena. At a steamship company agency, she exchanged her first-class ticket for 2 third-class tickets for herself and a woman with children. The words of the master Hilarion sounded in her soul. "Soon you will go to America, and there you begin your new work. Now you are not an eternal wanderer. You are the messenger. Joy to live, courage to live, courage to die, all merged for her into a radiant concept, to live for the good of the earth." And the globe is still spinning, calmly, rhythmically, and steadily, despite the suffering.